But look to your neighbor, to the right and to the left, if you have one, behind you or in front of you, and just shake their hand and say, "We're glad you're here this morning. We're so glad you came to share the love of Christ today. Let's saddle up and get up, still work to do today. Souls to save, His name to praise. Gotta get going while it's still day. Impact Cowboy Church of Nacogdoches. You're always welcome here in Nacogdoches. Impact Cowboy Church, where you still love, buddy."
Good morning, everybody. I said, good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
Hallelujah. I need to, before we do something, how many of you ever go into church and you hear people talk about faith? Anybody ever talk about faith? There's a faith that when we talk about faith, we need to talk about what we've got faith in. And something happened here a while back, and I want to really introduce you to somebody. This young lady right here is named Megan. And Megan came up here for the first time here a while back, and she walked in the church, said she absolutely loved this place. And where do you live at right now?
Baytown.
She lives in Baytown. She is quitting her job. She is leaving her house. She is moving all the way here to Nacogdoches, Texas, because she loves being here. And so when you hear stories like that, how many of you know we get used to church every day? We get used to seeing all the same old faces, and it's just the norm. But when you walk into a place and you say, "That's the place that I want to be." All right, so then you start asking yourself, if somebody's willing to make a commitment in their life based on faith that they want to be someplace else. And what is faith is not in the church. Amen?
That's right.
Oh, come on. Do you hear me? Faith is not in the church. Faith is in Jesus Christ and Christ alone. Him crucified, Him resurrected, Him walking on this earth and in ascending to the right hand of the Father, where He sits in defense of you. So when the accuser of the brethren, we all know his name is Scratch, is Satan. It is the enemy, whatever you want to refer to him as he is called the accuser of the brethren. Jesus is also our lawyer, our advocate that is pleading for us. And his blood covers all. Amen? So his blood is enough. So do me a favor. When y'all see her today, why don't y'all walk up here and give her a hug. Welcome her to Nacogdoches. She's going to be looking for a house. She's interviewing for jobs. She is trying to get her life started. And she's also a part of the Save Savage Ministries. We are starting a little small chapter here at Impact Cowboy Church. Matter of fact, Joey will be telling you about it later. So we're calling it the East Texas or Piney Woods Save Savage chapter will be out of here at Impact Cowboy Church. So guys, do me a favor. We got a lot of things happening all at one time. So we have a new family member here with us. Y'all make sure y'all love on her. Amen. Matter of fact, Psalms 33. Come on now. Get excited. I thought about you this morning whenever I was reading this. Psalms 33 says, "Sing joyfully to the Lord, you righteous. It is fitting for the upright to praise Him. Praise the Lord with the harp. Make music to Him on the 10-string lyre. Sing to Him a new song and play skillfully and shout for joy." So guys, I don't know about y'all, but worship is not a thing that we do. It is a contact sport. So it is a lot like wrestling. It is a lot like football. Reach out. And what the old saying for AT&T, reach out and touch someone. When you get into worship, reach out and touch God Almighty. Amen. He is waiting to receive your praise. All you got to do is give it. Amen. Let's pray. Father, in the mighty name of Jesus, Father, we thank you for Miss Megan, that Lord, as she's making her way up here to Nacogdoches. Father, we stand in agreement with her that, Lord, this is a life-altering change for her. But, Lord, it's a place that you're going to be using her to do the work of the ministry and, Lord, to be able to follow out your plans for her life. Father, we thank you in Jesus' name that, Father, that you're doing a new work here in Nacogdoches, Texas. And, Lord, we love seeing what it is that you're doing. And so, Father, as we try to do things that most churches don't, Lord, we ask that, Father, that you would show up and do what only you can do. So, Father, we thank you in Jesus' name that, Father, Satan has been put on notice. Father, your word says that the gates of hell will not prevail against your church. So, Lord, with that being said, that means that we need to start attacking those gates because, Lord, we see that the enemy needs to flee. So, Father, this is your place. This is your time. Father, these are your people. This is your building. This is your property. Every single thing here is yours, and we praise you. And, Lord, we say you are our God. So, Lord, we love you. And, Lord, as we sing praises to you this morning, Lord, there's only one that can receive those praises, and that is you. So, Father, we thank you, Father, for your presence. Lord, we thank you for the blood of Jesus. And, Lord, we thank you for the presence of the Holy Spirit here this morning to guide us, to instruct us, to teach us, and to fulfill us to be your church. So, Lord, all we want to do is say, Lord, we love you, and we ask that, Father, not only would you move here at Impact Cowboy Church, but, Lord, I just ask that you would move in every church here in Nacogdoches County, Father, where the gospel of Jesus Christ is being preached. Father, I pray that there's an end-time revival that would run through this nation, and, Father, people would start waking up, and that, Lord, they would realize they need Jesus. So, Lord, we praise you, and, Lord, we ask that, Father, if that's going to happen, Lord, let it start here first today. So, Lord, let everything we say and do today, Father, to be your honor, your glory, in Jesus' mighty name. And all God's people said?
Amen.
Amen. Welcome. Oh, yeah.
You guys want to gather around here. Let's praise the Lord. Let's get up here close and let's give him his rightful praise that he deserves.
Oh,
please?
Let's do that.
If you don't mind.
Someone jihad.
I kind of, my wires got crossed up. Apologize.
Slow or fast?
Forgive me, Lord. Hey.
The cleansing power, are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you fully trusting in His grace this hour? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you washed?
Are you washed
in the blood?
In the blood?
In the soul cleansing blood of the Lamb? Are your garments spotless? Are they white as snow? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you walking daily by the Savior's side? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Do you rest each moment in the crucified? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb?
Are you washed
in the blood?
In the blood?
In the soul cleansing blood of the Lamb? Are your garments spotless? Are they white as snow? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Glad morning when this life is over, I'll fly away to a home on God's celestial shore. I'll fly away. I'll fly away, oh glory. When I die, hallelujah, by and by, I'll fly away. Just a few more weary days and then I'll fly away to a land where joy shall never end. Yes, I'll fly away, oh glory, I'll fly away
in the morning.
And when I die, hallelujah, by and by, I'll fly away. Yes, I'll fly away, oh glory. When I die, hallelujah, by and by, I'll fly away. And when I die, hallelujah, by and by, I'll fly away.
We stumbled through it, but we got it.
I believe in the blood of Jesus that washes white as snow. I believe that the power of the gospel still makes the broken whole. I believe that the curse of sin was broken when they rolled away that stone. I believe, I believe, I believe. As I bow before you, Lord, I will rise in confidence. I will see your goodness, Lord, in the land I'm living in. No matter where I go, and no matter where I've been, I will see your goodness, Lord, in the land I'm living in. I believe that the walls will start falling when we fall down on our knees. I believe that the lame will go walking and the blind are gonna see. I believe that the gates of hell tremble when the church begins to sing. I believe. As I bow before you, Lord, I will rise in confidence. I will see your goodness, Lord, in the land I'm living in. No matter where I go, and no matter where I've been, I will see your goodness, Lord, in the land I'm living in. Sing it to the daughters, sing it to the sons, to every generation. Look at what the Lord has done. Sing it to the darkness, that the light has come. Sing it to the nations, look at what the Lord has done. Sing it to the daughters, sing it to the sons, to every generation. Look at what the Lord has done. Sing it to the darkness, that the light has come. Sing it to the nations, look at what the Lord has done. Look at what the Lord has done. As I bow before you, Lord, I will rise in confidence. I will see your goodness, Lord, in the land I'm living in. No matter where I go, and no matter where I've been, I will see your goodness, Lord, in the land I'm living in.
I can hear it, I can hear the sound of the promised land. I can hear it, it's a sound of redemption. I can feel it in my bones again. It's a sound of the promised land. Can you hear the mothers and fathers? Can you hear the sons and daughters? The shout and the praise of God. From one generation to the next, from one generation to the next, from one generation to the next, from one generation to the next. As I bow before you, Lord, I will rise in confidence. I will see your goodness, Lord, in the land I'm living in. No matter where I go, no matter where I've been, I will see your goodness, Lord, in the land I'm living in. As I bow before you, Lord, I will rise in confidence. I will see your goodness, Lord, in the land I'm living in. No matter where I go, and no matter where I've been, I will see your goodness, Lord, in the land I'm living in. amazing love that welcomes me, the kindness of mercy that bought with blood wholeheartedly my soul undeserving. God, you're so good. God, you're so good. Oh God, you're so good. You're so good to me.
Behold the dead are raised, the sinner saved, the work of your power.
God, you're so good. God, you're so
you are. God being so good to you.
the altars are always open here at Impact Cowboy right. Church. If you've got something on your heart, mind, need to talk to God about it, need somebody else to be up here and visit with you and pray with you on it, there they are. The pillows go on the ground for your knees.
Amen.
That's when God can really work.
I can only imagine what it will be like when I walk by your side. I can only imagine what my eyes will see when your face is before me. I can only imagine, yeah, I can only imagine. Surrounded by your glory, what will my heart feel? Will I dance for you, Jesus, or in love you be still? Will I stand in your presence? To my knees will I fall? Will I sing hallelujah? Will I be able to speak it all? I can only imagine. Yeah, I can only imagine. I can only imagine. When that day comes and I find myself standing in the sun, I can only imagine when all I will do is forever worship you. I can only imagine, yeah.
Rex, why don't y'all just kind of keep playing that. Church, it's my duty and responsibility to tell you something about this song. It leaves a lasting question that's in your mind. That day that you die and you pass away here on this earth and you go before God Almighty, what will you do? Will you stand? Will you sing? Will you dance? Will you run? Will you shout? Will you clap? What will you do? This last Friday, a friend of ours here at the church, Mr. Earl Bates, graduated from this planet, this earth, this world, this place, and he's already answering that question. He's already knowing what we will do. He's experiencing it face to face. And all of a sudden, we have these questions and we ask, but the one thing that I can tell you as a pastor, there's sometimes we cry and sometimes we're upset when people pass, but there are sometimes we celebrate. Because when you've lived your life to the point where you don't have to wonder, you don't have to worry. Guys, and I want to tell you something, Mr. Earl Bates was not perfect, but he was an awesome man. Amen. And as he came in here to serve, and as he would play guitar upon the praise and worship team, as he would make you all sorts of arts and craft stuff, this place is surrounded by things that he has made and put up on the walls, and it's a living tribute or testimony to a person who loves Jesus. And guys, when you come in, and yes, you may wonder from time to time whether or not your life is perfect. Guys, Jesus is not worried about your life being perfect. He was perfect for us. It's not our righteousness, it's His righteousness. And as we walk through this place and we walk through life, yes, sometimes you're going to get some bumps, and sometimes you're going to get knocked down. Sometimes your faith is going to be tested. But you know, the righteous man, the righteous woman keeps getting up, keeps going forward, and keeps doing everything. And guys, I'm here to tell you that whenever the word came in that he had went and seen Jesus, I can honestly tell you, without a doubt, I didn't shed a tear. But I wanted to stand up and I wanted to shout, amen. Well done, thy good and faithful servant.
Amen.
So guys, I just want to encourage you, just live your life every day for Jesus. Even in the midst of trials and tribulations and pains and things as they come, there's only one that matters, and His name is Jesus Christ. He is our Savior. He is our advocate. And most of all, He said that He was our friend. I don't know about y'all, but we lost a friend today, but heaven gained one. Amen. And I want to share this with you. Listen to me. Heaven didn't gain an angel. Y'all need to understand that. They gained a saint. Angels are different. But you see, he's already seen Jesus face to face. He's already known him as God knows and knew him. He's already beat us. He's already won the prize, so to speak. So guys, how many of you know that's worth celebrating? So as y'all ask, we don't know about directions or as far as where it's going to go, but they did say that possibly about October that we may do a service, you know, for him here. I'll let y'all know as we find out. Amen. But in the meantime, let's worship him. Amen. Let's stand before him. Let's sing. Let's shout. Let's dance. Let's bow down. Let's do all these things. Why? Because he's worthy of it. Amen. Father, in the mighty name of Jesus, Father, as we stand before you, and Lord, we declare that you are holy. Father, you are righteous. Lord, there is no other that, Father, you're worthy of all the respect, the glory, the honor. Lord, we see in the scriptures where you are the friend of sinners. And Lord, your word says this is how we know that he loved us yet while we were sinners. And Lord, sometimes we wonder, how can you love somebody that was a sinner? But in your providential plan, Lord, you knew that, Father, that you had a plan, Father, for Earl Bates. Father, you had a plan for each and every person in this room today. So, Father, we pray that, Lord, today as we celebrate, that, Lord, it's not about how good we feel. Lord, it's not a matter about how we're being edified, but how you're being glorified. So, Lord, as we stand in this place today, Lord, we say that Jesus Christ, and only Jesus Christ, is worthy of that praise. the lamb who was slain, the lamb who was sacrificed, the lamb that bled, the lamb that died, but yet also the lion that was resurrected. Oh, thank you, Jesus. That, Lord, that you fight our battles for us. That, Lord, that you walk with us. So, Lord, today is your day, as it is every day. Lord, come show us your presence here this morning. In Jesus' mighty name. And all God's people said, amen. Why don't y'all give him a loud hand clap? Amen.
Have I got any first-time visitors with us this morning? Anybody that's never, ever been to Impact Cowboy Church before, if you just raise your hand, we'd like to give you a visitor card, tell you how much we appreciate you being here this morning and worshiping Jesus Christ with your family here at Impact Cowboy Church. If you're here, you are family. Save Savages will be ministering at Lugnuts this afternoon at 2 p.m. So we've got a bunch of the guys with us. And I think they may be talking about it here in a minute. But anyway, that is a great ministry. Jesus says go out into the world, not stay in the side of the church house all the time. That means the arenas, the motorcycles, the bars, wherever you at your work, you can minister the word of God. Or be an example to others. Wednesday night services are at 7 p.m. Hope you can join us. Rayford Allen's Adult Sunday School class meets every Sunday morning from 9 to 9:45 in the youth building right out this door. And I believe, Brenda, I think you can take over most of this.
Good morning. Wasn't that worship good today? Hallelujah. I feel better. Woo, it was good. Okay, so real quick on the bulletin, obviously you can read it. It's got the information. The Runner's Refuge Recovery Ranch work day is coming up on August 12th. So be sure if you are able to do that to go join them on that. The Men and Women's Ministry is coming up on Monday, August 14th. Ladies, I told y'all that I would not be here because we are traveling to Alabama this weekend to move Addison in her dorm, and we'll be traveling back. But Danielle is going to take over the women's class for us, and we are in Matthew 5, 13 through 16. We're doing Salt and Light, so be sure to be prepared for a good discussion on that. George had mentioned that we have some more information on our missionaries in the back. Our bulletin board has not been put back together. Please excuse it, but it's a little raw. But there are some updates from a few of our missionaries back there. In one specific, Dark and Elizabeth Wood, we do finally have a video update from them. So we're going to play that this morning. They are under a lot of persecution and a lot of hard times right now. They need our prayers desperately. So please be sure to check that bulletin for their specifics on that.
God love you. God wants you to be saved. He wants you to be saved.
support. Thank you so much. It's a real blessing.
Hi. Thank you for your support.
From the Surfside family, thank you for your support. God bless you. You are doing so much work in the kingdom, and we are grateful for that. Thank you so much.
I'm going to the Surfside Christian Center, and then that's where God is.
I just want to thank God for His goodness, His mercies, and His love upon us here at Surfside Family Fellowship Church. I bless God because this is the sanctuary of God.
Thank you for your support, my dear sisters and brothers. Your support will not be a support, but a long life with Christ in the next coming. Yeah.
Thank you for your support, and God bless you all.
God bless you.
God bless
you. Thank you for your support. God bless you.
God bless you, and thank you.
So much for your blessings, and thank you for supporting this church and Sunday, Pastor Dirk and Elizabeth. We are so thankful for
them.
Thank you, God bless you.
Okay,
thank you.
Thank you, God bless you.
God bless you.
God bless you.
Thank you.
God bless you.
We love you.
Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you.
We love the church.
Here we are, and it's nice to know you're over there and you're supporting the cause, and you're making a big difference here. We can feel it. Thank you very much.
We love you.
And thank you so much.
Oh, yes, I thank you. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Amen.
Guys, y'all don't know this, but y'all helped start that church. You helped finance that church. That church is in Cape Town, South Africa, a place that was dealing with apartheid for many, many, many years, where people didn't mix and people didn't do that. Let me tell you something. Church is a place where they're supposed to mix. Church is a place where they're supposed to rejoice and celebrate. And guys, I want you to know that's our sister church that's pastored by Dirk Woods. The money that y'all send them every month helps them have church every month. Listen to me. They don't have much money. Matter of fact, most of those people that are in that church live in slums, cardboard boxes, crates, and stuff like that. So when you see their clothes, that is the best that they have. And they wear it Sunday. They've actually been robbed during the middle of church service, where gangs came in with guns and actually tried to take their tithe. And praise God, they fought them back and they won and took the money back. Amen. So that's the kind of people that we're dealing with. But as we get ready to celebrate, we have one other thing that's special today before we go on any further announcements. There's a young little girl here by the name of Miss Clara that has come to me, and she was ready to get baptized. And I don't know about y'all, but I love baptisms, and I love to be able to see people getting their lives straight and having a public testimony to what's going on in their lives. So as the whole family's here, I hear there's about 25 of them. Guys, why don't y'all come on up here and let's get this thing going on. Guys, do me a favor. Why don't you give Miss Claire a hand clap as she comes. So I felt bad last week. The baptisms we had last week, the heater did not work. And it was cold. So we got us a brand new heater this week, put it in there so the water is warm. And as we start seeing, she gets in there, she won't be screaming at the top of her lungs. So family, y'all are welcome. Why don't y'all come on up here to be with us. Miss Claire, I want you to know something. I'm really proud. Where's Papa at? All right. Papa, why don't you come over on this side over here? Austin, you come on over here. Hey, young, I'm staying. Hey, let's see. All right, so guys, this young lady right here, come on up here, step up on the step so they can see you. Miss Claire is, how old are you now? She's 10 years old. She's one of the most beautiful little people inside and out that you'll ever see. She melted my heart the other day when she walked up and just came, gave me a hug up out of nowhere. If you ever want something from Pastor Stan, just give me a hug. Amen. That'll melt your heart. But whenever you're also giving your life to Christ Jesus, and when you say, Jesus, I am a sinner in need of a Savior, will you be my Savior? At that point in time, you are saved. Now, the Bible says that we're supposed to follow after in baptism. It's a commandment. It's something that we do, but it's a public testimony. And I want to tell you, I am so proud of you for the public declaration that you're making here today. Because now you get a chance to be held accountable for everything in your life. So all these people that you see up in here, if you mess up, they're going to have the right to be able to say, hey, you remember? You gave your testimony. And that's what today is. Today is a testimony. So when we lay down, the Bible says that we go down in the grave, that when we go down in the grave, the old person passes away no longer. And when we come back up, they're a new person. How many of you know that's a wonderful celebration to have? Amen. Well, y'all do me a favor. Would y'all lift your hands this way as we pray for her? I'm going to pray for her before we get her into the water. Father, in the mighty name of Jesus, Father, we thank you. And Lord, we celebrate with you today. Father, this testimony of Miss Clara giving her life to you and, Father, making this public declaration of her faith for you. Lord, I ask in Jesus' name that, Father, that you would just touch her, Lord, today. Father, seal her in her faith. And Lord, we thank you that, Lord, that you have a calling and anointing for her in life. That, Lord, not only is she going to be walking in your way, but, Lord, I also pray that, Father, that you have a designed appointment, Father, for her. That, Lord, will be divine in nature, and that, Lord, that you're going to use her, Father, continue your work here for on your kingdom on this earth. So, Lord, we just celebrate today, and, Lord, we speak your blessings upon her. And, Lord, we ask that, Father, that you would activate her and her gifts and callings, that, Lord, she'll leave today, Father, on fire for you, and, Lord, look and say what Jesus has done for me. So, Father, we thank you for this young girl, and, Lord, we thank you for her family. Lord, we ask for your blessings to be upon her in Jesus' mighty name. All God's people said, all right. Young lady, would you mind coming on in? Papa, you want to help her so she don't slip and fall? You ready? Papa, if you'll stand right over there. Oh, man, we can put some crawfish up in this thing. Amen. Go ahead and sit down. Okay, y'all got her? Y'all ready? All right. Miss Clara, because you've asked Jesus Christ to be your Lord and Savior, and you've asked him not only to be your Savior, but you are convinced of it, and you want to follow after him in baptism, we now baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you, Tom. Good job. Good job, young man. Sorry it's wet. Papa, congratulations, young man. Guys, won't y'all do at the end of the service when y'all see her, won't y'all come up here and give her a hand clap? The family is coming up here. How many of you know it's awesome when you can have the family come celebrate something like this? Amen. So y'all are welcome here. We'd love to have y'all. Thank y'all for being here this morning. Guys, y'all go have your seat. All right, Jesse. You turn that knob off for me. It's that little switch.
Check one, two, check, 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 check.
Stand by me. You can stand by me. Contrast the beauty in the
back. Darling, darling, stand by me. Oh.
I think I'm through now.
I love you too, Rachel.
All right. I hate to get up here so late, but I'm going to take a Stan King 1 minute, which probably be 15. But I went out to Village NAC the other day and presented them that check that we sent those people. They were overwhelmed at the size of the check and the thoughtfulness, all the bags that they sent. We had a chance to visit with them and catch up on what was going on. They still have about 25, 22, something like that, residents, but they also have another four or five houses that need to be finished out. They notified me that the college changing from SFA to UT, they lost a lot of funding to finish out these houses. But Constance is out there trimming trees so that they can run power lines to the houses they have. The commitment that woman has is beyond my comprehension. She works crazily to help these people. Those that don't know about Village Knack, it's a place where people who have lost things, lost their house because medical bills, down on their luck in one way or the other, and living in their cars, she provides them a tiny house to live in. It's a very worthy thing. She wanted to convey her thanks for the check and the support, and she gave me another small list that would be on the back table of things that they need out there. So you can look it up. I'm not going to read it because I don't want to take the time away from Jesse because he's much better looking than I am. But if you'll pick that up, I got hair.
Lucky.
I got a good shaped head.
Okay. But anyhow, I just wanted to give you an update on these people. They're still doing God's work out there. They still need support and prayers. And we thank you for what you do for them. If you need any information on them, you can contact me after the service. And here's Jesse.
Sorry, actually.
There's more.
Wait. You got up here before. You should be through.
I forgot something. Ladies, real quick. Also on the bulletin board, we have two women's conferences that are coming up in September. One is to the Terrell Cowboy Church that several of us have gone to. It's always really good. And then there's also one in Longview. So just be sure to check that bulletin board out. I forgot to mention that. There's a couple of flyers with the ticket information and the dates and times on there. Now here's Jesse.
Anybody else? 5, 4, 3, 2. Miss Kay. I didn't get that much fish. I got about 50 pounds. I brought 50 pounds back with me, so there will be some divvied out. Don't worry. Don't worry. Not enough for everybody unless we have a miracle like, you know, the loaves and fish. Well, good morning, Impact Cowboy Church. It's good to see all smiling faces. I missed y'all, you know, last Sunday and Wednesday. But it's good to be back in the house of the Lord. Good to be back with the family. Good to see everybody here. So the offering from last week, $5,061.75. Woo! And that video that we just watched is a part of it. That's where your money goes. That's where your tithes and your offerings go. And I'm going to say it every Sunday. Give your tithes and your offerings. It spreads the gospel. This is a good, solid foundation to give your tithes and offerings to. So we have $4,586 go towards tithes. We have $5.75 go towards the Children's Fund. Children's VBS fundraiser, we raised $240. Rodeo Arena Fund, we had $200. Missions, $120. Outreach Fund, $5. Building Fund, $55. Women's Ministry Fund, $25, and Youth Fund, $25. We're spreading the love. We're spreading the love, and I love it. I come home from long vacation, and I come home to church family, and I see how God is taking care of his people, how God's taking care of the church. So that's because of y'all. It's because you giving your tithes and your offerings. So I'm going to pray over this, and we'll keep rolling. Lord, thank you for this day. Thank you, God, for this offering of $5,061.75. Lord, we give it right back to you. And we ask for your wisdom on what to do with it, where to put it, what ministries to fund, what ministries not to fund, God, because sometimes there's things that aren't of you, Lord. But, God, I thank you for the wisdom that we have here and the places that we put it. God, I just thank you for this Sunday morning. Pray your kingdom come, your will be done on earth in heaven as it is in earth. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, now I need all my kiddos back in the back. Make sure y'all go to the bathroom. Grown-ups, make sure y'all go to the bathroom first, too, before we get started. So, love you guys.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, babe. All right, good morning, guys. Let's go ahead and try to get our morning started here real quick. We've got a lot to get through, and what did the old song, got a long way to go and a short time to get there, amen? Eastbound and watch them truckers roll. We're going to have to go this morning. One of the things we're going to be doing, I'm encouraging you today, right after church service, we are not going to have a lot of time to hang out. We're going to be getting ready to go to Lugnuts to be able to have our Save Savages church services. If you are a first time here at Impact Cowboy Church, what I'm fixing to say to you is going to freak you the heck out. We are going to be having a church service at a bar. All right, we've been doing this. We're setting it up, what is it, on the first Sundays of every month? Is that correct? First Sunday of every month, we're setting up to be able to do a service. And here's the reason being is if you look on the door when you walk outside, it says in the scripture, go ye into all the world to preach the gospel of Jesus Christ, the good news unto all the world. Amen? So where does that mean? Every other place other than just here. Amen? We got to get out to go where people are at. And how many of you know just because you have a church service doesn't mean that they're going to come into it? Jesus went and found the lepers. He went and found the sinners. He went and found the tax collectors. Heck, he even went and found some fishermen. Amen? How many of you know Jesus was hard up for some people to follow? Especially if he's getting people like that to come on part of his ministry team. So guys, what I want to encourage you to, some of you say, well, I would never walk into a bar. Let me ask you a question. Would you walk into a bar to be able to pray for a sinner that wants to receive Christ Jesus as their Lord and Savior? Remember, holiness is not necessarily what we do, what we say, what we do here, but are we bringing other people into Christ Jesus by living a life that we can say he is worthy of going out into all the world? So guys, I don't know if y'all have noticed, but how many of you realize we're in a drought right now? Anybody? All right, so yesterday had a thing. Mr. Jackson, Emily, got married yesterday, and there was a celebration that was over there. And as we go into the celebration, I want you to listen to me. It was 105 degrees yesterday for an outside wedding. How many of you know that's when you know you're in a drought? And so, guys, well, all of a sudden we saw this happening. I have been rejoicing for this wedding for quite some time. I'm extremely excited. I just can't wait for them to be able to be here that first Sunday where I can introduce them here from the pulpit as husband and wife. It's a celebration. Let me tell you something. That would have been worth going to 125 degrees outside to watch it happen. Amen? But yet we need to get things cooled down here in the United States really quickly. We have a little picture I want to show you. I cannot tell you how truthful this is. Would you mind killing the stage lights up here so they can see it just a little bit better? This may be a joke, but this is what it feels like. This was passing around, and everything around us is cooler weather and rainfall. Look and see where Texas is at. Sometimes that's where we feel like we're at, amen? And when you're in the middle of a drought, guess what? It is your responsibility to start praying for rain. And not only praying for rain, but you got to start believing in rain. So when you start praying for rain and you start believing for rain, guess what? You better start acting like it's going to rain. So get your raincoats out when you pray and start believing that what you pray for that Jesus will give you. Guys, I don't know about y'all, but I looked on the radio or looked on the TV and I didn't see hardly anything in the forecast other than triple degrees. All right, guys, I don't know about y'all, but there was a young man that saw this movie set that was coming in, and they were making a movie. And all of a sudden, he would go up there, and he wanted to see what was going on. And the next day, they were discussing about getting some of these actors and some of these extras to come in. And this guy said, well, hey, I'm going to get this guy to be an extra. And so the guy says, well, I don't think you're going to be able to film tomorrow. It's going to rain tomorrow really hard. And lo and behold, it started raining like nobody's business. Matter of fact, it rained so much, there must have been 10 inches of rain that came down within a five-hour period. It was massive raining. The producer was so impressed with the young man, he decided that he wanted to ask him the next time they decided to do a big shoot. And they said, hey, young man, what's the weather forecast for tomorrow? He said, it's going to be storming. He said, there's going to be hailstorms. It's going to be bad. And lo and behold, a hailstorm came, and they had golf ball-sized hail that came in and destroyed all the equipment. And the guy said, man, I'm so impressed by this guy. He said, I want to hire him to be our advisor for weather for this movie set. So he told the secretary, get with this young man, hire him. And then all of a sudden, the guy, he disappears, and you hadn't seen him for about a week. And on a movie set, that's a long time. So all of a sudden, the guy comes back, and the movie producer comes up and says, hey, young man. Where you been? I need a weather forecast. I need what's going on. What can you tell me? And the guy and the young man looked at him and said, I don't know. My radio quit working. I can't tell you. How many of you know sometimes that's the way we do our weather forecasting is we look on TV and we listen to the radio and we believe what they say. And I'm here to tell you, weather forecasters need to get saved because they can be liars here in the state of Texas. You know, they always say that you don't like the weather, stick around 10 minutes. It's going to raise up another 10 degrees, amen? So all of a sudden, what we need to do is we need to start acting in faith and start praying in faith, and not just having just faith alone, but faith in Christ Jesus, that what he said, that when we ask, that we will receive. Guys, right now, we need some rain. Our grass needs some rain. Our yards need some rain. Our electric bills need some rain, amen? So guys, will you stand in agreement with us as we get started that we'll pray for rain, that we will see it? We are going to be preaching about rain for probably the next couple of weeks. And I have a feeling by the time we get through with it, we're going to see some massive rain break out. I have to declare that by faith because I sure ain't seeing it on TV, but I believe that Christ is good enough and able enough to be able to answer our prayers in Jesus' name, amen? Father, in the mighty name of Jesus, Father, as we begin this service this morning, Father, we thank you that, Lord, that you're going to do a complete and total powerful work. That, Lord, as we saw in that picture, that, Lord, it looked like the state of Texas was singled out. Lord, I know not if it was true, and, Lord, it may be a joke, but, Lord, that's the way it feels. So, Lord, I ask in Jesus' name that, Father, that you would reverse that picture. That, Lord, we would see, Father, rain throughout the state of Texas. Lord, we will see it from El Paso to Longview, Father. We'll see it from Amarillo to Corpus Christi. And Lord, we will see, Father, grass growing back, hay growing back, Father, cows growing back. Lord, we're hearing that there's a massive sell-off going on at the sale barns over cattle. Father, they said there was 2,000 that sold last week, and Lord, they're expecting 3,000 for this upcoming week. But Lord, we ask in Jesus' name that, Father, that you would bring the rain and turn this thing around. That, Lord, that you would save the herds, the crops. That, Lord, that you would provide. And Lord, your word says that, Father, if we believe, Lord, even in the middle of being tested in the desert, in the drought, that Lord, you work this thing inside of us that proves who we are in Christ Jesus. So Lord, we ask in Jesus' name that Father, that you would reveal yourself here today in a powerful way. So Lord, we love you, we praise you, we thank you in Jesus' name. And all God's people said, there's been some times we've prayed for rain here and it would just start raining during church service. And about the time that you would make a point, all of a sudden thunder and lightning would happen. And it was almost like God was saying amen. And I love those moments. I love it whenever you're preaching with authority and power and it sounds like all of heaven is joining alongside of you. But how many of you know there's some times that we live in the desert. We live out here in the frontier area. We live in the place where there's not a lot of rain. And guys, this is Texas summer. We have some friends that have moved here to the church in the country, and they came from Oregon, and she was asking, who ordered this 105-degree temperature? It's like, hey, welcome to Texas, baby. This is what it is. But in the meantime, I want you to start understanding, even though you may be in a point of suffering, you may be in a point of testing, you may be in a trial or tribulation, these things are kind of like kidney stones. They hurt like heck, but they too shall pass. And when it does, listen to me, God is going to show up and show out in a mighty way here in Jesus' name. Guys, if you would, I want you to turn around and turn to Matthew chapter 4, please. I'm going to have to rush through our service today. And so I'm going to keep it in the wind the best that I can. In Matthew chapter 4, verses 1 through 4. So normally, if y'all are here with me, normally I'm out of the New Living Translation, but when I went to go see Earl, I forgot my Bible in his hospital room here in Nacogdoches, Texas. They transferred him to Tyler, and they thought my Bible was his, and they packed it up in his stuff and shipped it to Tyler. And so I haven't had my Bible, so I had to go back into my old one, And guys, listen to me. When you go back into your old Bibles, the ones you haven't opened up in a year or so, your memories just get flooded, the things that you used to study, the things that you saw in that Bible. It just brings back something new. And so today I'm actually preaching out of the NIV, 1984 version. And it says in Matthew chapter 4, starting in verses 1 through 4, and it talks about Jesus being tested in the wilderness, which is in the translation for that is a desert. Guys, it said Jesus is tested. Guys, you will be tested. How many of you feel like you're being tested right now? So, Pastor, I'll pass the test when you shut up. Amen? But, guys, starting in verses 1, it says, then Jesus was led by the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted by the devil. Guys, listen to me. If Jesus was going to be tempted by the devil, guess what? You are going to be too. We're not exempt from testing. And it says in verse 2, after fasting for 40 days and 40 nights, he was hungry. The tempter came to him and said, if you are the Son of God, tell these stones to become bread. Jesus answered, it is written, man shall not live on bread alone, but on every word that comes from the mouth of God. Point number one, listen to me. You will be tempted even with your physical needs. How many of you have been hungry before in life? Somebody skipped a meal, somebody fasted. Next thing you know, you wasn't able to get any food. Guys like us, the big guys, boy, if we miss a meal, somebody's going to be hurting. Amen? We're going to find a place to go get something to eat, and I don't care if it's a truck stop. We're going to find something. But guys, when you've been fasting for 40 days and 40 nights, listen to me, it's not an easy thing to do. But sometimes when you're out there in the middle of the drought, you're in the middle of the desert, you're in the middle of the wilderness, there is nothing to separate you from the power of God. Because, guys, I couldn't imagine what it'd be like to be here and not be able to eat for 40 days. I've done it before, and it's not an easy thing. And at the end of 40 days, there's two things that you find out about yourself. You're not as strong as you thought you was. But the second thing that you find out is God is a whole lot more powerful than you ever dreamed. Why? Because he can get you through those moments when nobody else can. And what I want you to hear today is that if Jesus went through the testing and the trials and tribulations, so will you. And guys, I've heard a lot of people saying, I don't want to have to be tried and tested. And let me tell you something. If God saved you from that but made his son go through it, then that would mean that he actually loved you more than he loved his son. He is a respecter of no man. We will all go through the times of trials and tribulations. But they're designed to make you stronger, to make you better. They're designed to be able to teach you something, to learn to quit relying on yourself and rely on him. Guys, I don't know about y'all, but when we rely on our own selves, we got problems. When we rely on him, we find out even in the desert, even in the dry place, that he is still God of all. Provision is the one place that sometimes the devil will mess with you. How many of you know when you look in your checking account, you don't have much money left? It's easy to turn around and say, Lord, what are you about to do? Because I've only got $15 left. And man, I got to go 3 days. How am I going to stretch $15 for 3 days? Guys, I don't care who you are. There's been each and every person that's in this room has probably went through a moment like that. You're thinking, how am I going to do it? And then your faith starts waning. Then your faith starts getting weak. Then you start worrying, God, how are you going to do this? And then what happens? Then you whip out the old credit card. Da-da-da-da-da-da, charge. And there you got that credit card, and all of a sudden you're mounting up a bill. I saw this thing the other day. It was 32% interest on a new credit card. Guys, do you know that would be ignorant? As a friend of mine that graduated from A&M, he used to say, it's ignorant. Why? Because 32%, man, how many of you know a lot of times when you start charging up small things become big things really quick. And what happens is when we start trying to test those small things, and the next thing you know, you get your month, and it's a monthly bill of $1,000, but with 32% interest, all of a sudden now you're paying a whole lot more than that. Guys, Jesus he's good enough, he's able. And not only is he good enough and able, but he's faithful enough to provide for you in your time of need. Guys, how many of you have seen any skinny birds outside? Anybody? Have you seen any skinny birds in your front porch? How many of you have got bird feeders out there? How many of you watch those birds come in? Let me tell you something, just as you provide for those birds, God provides for you. And when you give this opportunity to say, Jesus, I'm going to praise you, I'm going to glorify you, and I'm going to stick with you, and I'm going to trust nobody else but you, because let me tell you something, the angel that looks like light is probably not. His name is Satan. He will come and try to fool you, and he'll try to make you do something different. And guys, let me tell you, if Jesus is turning around and saying, if God provides for the birds, he will provide for you. Amen. Matter of fact, we just saw a young man. I know it's not the only person in church. Young man just graduated. Mr. Mason just graduated college with magna cum laude. And I don't know about y'all, but I am so proud of that young man to see him go through these things. But how many of you know that you don't graduate with a magna cum laude without little effort, without putting time, without studying? Guys, in your time, there's some going to be things, I can't make it through this, I can't do this. You can't if that's what you believe. But if you believe that you can, you will put the extra work. But your faith has got to rise up that when Jesus said something, that he will provide. Amen? And so when you see where he got tested, I love the fact that I have a Savior that was tested. Because if he wasn't tested, what would his testimony be like? Oh, come on. He couldn't be perfect if he wasn't tried. He couldn't be perfect unless he stood up against the devil. Guys, I don't know about y'all, but it's easy to turn around and say, boy, I'd just love to have a good piece of bread with some butter and some garlic sauce on that. Hey, by the way, let's go on up to Napoli's and let's get some spaghetti. Hey, let's get some lasagna. Let's not stop there. Let's get them rolls that they got with some Parmesan on it. Guys, listen to me. You don't need bread. You need the Word of God. And the Word of God will feed you and take care of you when nothing else will. Because let me tell you something, that bread, you're going to eat it, and guess what? It's going to be gone. But yet the Word of God will sustain you all of your life. Guys, there's some times when you're heartbroken, and yet the Word of God sustains you. The moment that I heard about Earl, let me tell you something. The one thing that stood out, and it just, and I couldn't help but say it, when his daughter said, he just passed, it's just happened. All I could hear in my spirit screaming, well done, thy good and faithful servant. If that don't make you happy, the Word of God rises up right when you need it to give you some edification, to give you hope, to give you something to go find. But yet the enemy is always right there in your ear, ain't he? How many of you know, you see the old commercials where the angel's on one shoulder and the devil's on the other? And they just sit there and whisper into your ear? Guys, I don't know about y'all, but man, mine ain't whispering. Mine's hollering half the time. You know, and he's turning around saying, oh, you can't believe that. You can't trust that. But let me tell you something. When we started looking around, I ain't seen another church in Nacogdoches, Texas that's got 53 acres of property. I've never seen another church that has the people that we have here in this church. And the thing about it is, when you have faith that God will do what he says he'll do, then it made what we did when we left Arlington come down here to make it seem, yes, God has a plan. And he has a plan for each and every one of you. If he provides, let me tell you something, he will take care of you. In verses 5 through 7 there in Matthew 4, it says, then the devil took him to the holy city and had him stand on the highest point of the temple. And if you are the Son of God, he said, throw yourself down, for it is written, he will command his angels concerning you, and he will lift you up in their hands so that you will not strike your foot against a stone. Jesus answered him, it is also written, do not put the Lord your God to the test. Point number 2, listen to me, you will be tempted to even test God. You see, as Satan started turning around and speaking to Jesus, hey, if you are the Son of God, how many remember the last time that he said, did God really say that? Who did he say that to? Adam and Eve, right? Guys, how many of you know he deceived Adam and Eve, and guess what? The fall of man happened. And here he is now talking to the Son of God, Jesus Christ, saying, if you are the Son, how many of you know he was trying to cast doubt on who Jesus was? How many of you have had Satan try to get you to cast doubt on who you are? Leaving California to come start a group called Save Savages. To be able to leave your town and all of a sudden move up to Nacogdoches. Let me tell you something. The devil will try to speak to you, but I'm here to tell you the Word of God will always reassure you and bring you to a place. And guys, we don't need to hear that loud screaming. Man, God just speaks in that still, quiet voice. How many of y'all remember Mama when you were growing up and you got in trouble? Mama didn't have to yell at you. How many of you know they just had that look and that, I'm fixing to get you? And you straightened up. And that was the one voice that covered over the TV. It covered over all the noise of the other kids playing, and it struck fear in your heart. But you see, when God speaks in that same still, quiet voice, and he says, I got you. I've got you. I will take care of you. Guess what? God is letting you know that above all the noise, above all the other stuff, he is always going to be right there with you. Guys, I want you to understand the devil is a liar and there's no truth in him. Oh, come on. Y'all need to shout amen over that. And every time the devil says that you're going to fail, guess what? If you know his voice, then you can turn around and know that whatever he's saying is a lie. So if he's telling you that you're going to fail, then God's telling you you're going to pass. If the devil's turning around and tell you you're going to fall flat on your face, and that means that you're going to be standing up face to face with God, and you're not going to have to worry about what Satan says. Sometimes we fall for the lies of the enemy simply because we don't have faith enough in the word that God has given us. And sometimes God has spoken a word, whether it's over you, whether it's over your children, whether it's over your finances, whether it's over your health, and all of a sudden you question, are you being truthful with me, God? But let me tell you something, God ain't never lied. His word says that it will not come back void. It will succeed what he purposed it for. And so when he has spoken over you that your marriage is going to be healed, that your children are not going to be so knot-headed tomorrow, that your husband will say, I'm sorry. How many of you know that's going to take a miracle? Amen? Husbands, y'all heard that. The wives are already laughing. And when God tells the husband, your wife will submit to you. No tomatoes, all right? No tomatoes. But guys, listen to me. What God said will happen. Guys, there's a scripture that talks about that Satan is going to get his head bruised by a heel. I'm so excited. I can't wait that Jesus says, get underneath my feet. That's my child. That's my servant. That's my friend. That's my sister, my brother. Jesus loves us so much that he died and went to the cross. Well, I know we overuse that so much, but let me try to challenge you this. Not only did he die and go to the cross and die for you, but he loved you so much that he fulfilled the Father's promise that he rose up out of that grave. He was the original rolling stone. Amen. That when that stone rolled out and all of a sudden that light came forth and all of a sudden those Roman guards fell asleep, they were passed out. Here's Jesus getting up in the midst of the place and saying, I am. Oh, come on, you didn't catch it. He's saying, I am. Guys, I don't know about y'all, but Jesus is our Savior. He is our friend. He is the one that we lean to. He is the one that wants to set you free. And I love what Jesus is doing, because here's all of a sudden, Satan has tempted him with all the kingdoms. He's tempted him with all the power. He's tempted him with all of the glory, all the money. How many of you know that money fades? Oh, come on. How many of you have seen money come and go in your pocket? How many of you got a lot less digits in your wallet right now than what you used to? All right, so you can get a $50 bill in your hand, go to dinner, you won't have nothing left. How many of you know that power changes? Glory, all this stuff that we see throughout the world. Let me tell you something. You can be a hero today and you can be a zero tomorrow. That's just the way the world works. We don't need to nearly be known as a hero. The only thing we need to be known as is a servant of God. And when you're a servant of God, listen to me, you can call forth for rain. Are you hearing what I'm saying? If you're a servant of God, you can call forth for people to come to Christ Jesus at the cross, repent, and guess what? You will see it happen. Y'all know that I grew up as a homeless person, and one of the first times that I ever had an opportunity to be able to preach was at a mission in Fort Worth, and I was able to preach to probably 150, I guess, homeless people. And at the end of the service, when we saw people coming down to the altar, and all I could think is, God, who am I to be able to come before these people and be able to preach the word of God and see them change? It's not a matter of who I am, it's who he is. You see, it doesn't matter who's filling this pulpit, it's who's inside that person in the pulpit. You see, you don't have to have credentials, you don't have to have ordination, you don't have to have a college degree, but you do have to have the blood of the Lamb. And if you got the blood of the Lamb, you can speak with authority and power. Guys, I want you to turn around, and I want you to also look at this, verses 5 through 7. It says, then he took him to the holy city and had him stand at the highest point of the temple. Guys, how many of you ever been tempted in church that you could do something better than somebody else? You could sing better, you could play better, you could preach better. Let me tell you something. If God thought you could do it better, he'd have you doing it. How about you serving right where you're at? How just about to start saying, the word says that I am just going to keep my eyes focused on Jesus. That prize which I've been called for, you keep your eyes on where Jesus called you, and guess what? You won't have to worry about anyplace else. Guys, don't go to this point where you start testing God to do something different. Sometimes we say, we're going to test God. I'm going to try to finance. I'm going to go up there to the car lot and get me a new car. I'm just going to see. Guys, listen to me. Unless God tells you to go buy a car right now, you better not. But if God tells you to go do it, then you better do it. Why? Because he'll provide. And we got good people here that'll take care of you doing so and give you good interest rates. But listen to me. Always obey what God said. Don't test him. Don't get out there and go do something that he didn't tell you to do. Verses 8 through 11, it said, again, Jesus is being tempted, said the devil took him to a very high mountain and showed him all the kingdoms of the world and their splendor. All of this I'll give you, he said, if you will bow down and worship me. Jesus said, away from me, Satan, for it is written, worship the Lord your God and serve him only. Then the devil left him and the angels came and attended him. Guys, listen to me. The devil wants to stop your worship. And worship is something that's interesting. If you go back and follow the word, the translation from the word worship, it's almost kind of embarrassing because it's a sign of affection. It's a sign of love. How many of you know when we worship him, it's a sign of love? But here's what the translation says, to passionately kiss or to lick. How many of you got a dog that likes to lick you? How many of you have been in somebody's house and dog jumped up in your face and started licking you? And you've got like this alien thing up in this alien tongue coming out at you. And you're trying to be nice to these people and say, oh, no, no, I love dogs. I love dogs. It's all right. But you see, that dog is trying to lick you. He's trying to kiss you. And that is a perfect example of what we ought to be like in Christ Jesus, that we love him so much. They're not embarrassed. How many of you know we ought not be embarrassed to worship our Jesus? We ought to not be worshiped. Now, let me tell you something. If you try to go home and you try to start doing that to your spouse, you might have a problem. You're going to get hit upside the head with a frying pan, all right? It ain't going to be pretty. So I'm not telling you to go home. Thank you. I'm not telling you to go home and start licking somebody you love. Don't do that. But get passionate when you serve and you love Jesus. Spend time, the original version said, to kiss passionately. How many of you know when marriage is whenever you quit kissing passionately, the marriage changes? Oh, come on. How many of you know so many times we just start giving that little peck on the cheek? That ain't the kind of relationship Jesus Christ wants. Jesus wants that full embrace. He wants that loving. You wait till we get home. He wants to know that you're going to get passionate for him and him alone. Guys, do you understand what I'm saying? Quit giving Jesus just a peck on the cheek. He went to the cross and got buried into a tomb and came back out of that thing. Let me tell you something. He deserves better than a peck on the cheek. He deserves better. Matter of fact, he deserves that passionate love. Now, guys, there comes a point in time where you have to say, you finally look at that dog and say, enough is enough. Stop. Let me ask you a question. Have you loved Jesus enough to where he'd have to turn around and say, enough? It's okay, stop. Have you loved him that much? Have you loved him to the point where he'd say, I got you. I understand. Now give me a towel. But if the devil were to stop your worship, do you know that he wants you to stop worshiping him, but he wants you to do the same thing to him? How many of you have seen Jesus ever turn around and say, it is written, it is written, it is written. Guys, I don't know about y'all, but we don't need anything else other than Jesus. goes, guys, he says he can give you all the kingdoms and governments. How many of you know right now there's governments going wrong all over the world? Countries are falling in coups. We're seeing these governments falling due to debt. Let me tell you something. A kingdom will come and go here on this earth, but the kingdom of God will last forever. I had a dog one time, and I'll finish up on this one for about the dog part. Had this dog one time that he used to love it when I would come home, and he would hide, and he would get up underneath this bush, and he would wait for me to come around the corner, and then his rear end would just sink way down low, and his little butt would start wiggling. And then all of a sudden, as soon as I cleared the corner, that dog would run at me full speed and just jump right up into my arms every day. And that dog would just start licking on me, and then he'd just start whelping and hollering, and he'd put his legs around each side of my neck and just hold and hug. And man, I just sit there. When you come home from a bad day, how many of you had a bad day at work recently? And you kept thinking, boy, it sure'd be nice if I came home and somebody was interested in seeing me. And all of a sudden, it's only the dog is interested in seeing you. Now, my wife is always happy to see me, amen. But all of a sudden, you start thinking about that. How awesome would it be if Jesus comes walking into our house and we're so excited and so ready that we're just shaking all over, that we're willing to jump up in his arms and just wail and just cry and just lick him. Guys, listen to me. That's what I'm trying to tell you today. Your passion is what Jesus Christ desires, not your slobber. Amen. Jesus don't need our slobber, but he does need our passion. So when we start looking, seeing what Jesus said to him, and I want you to catch this. He said to worship the Lord your God and serve him only. How many of you know that sometimes we serve other things in life? We serve our appetites. We serve our desires. We serve our wants. We serve our checking accounts. We serve our spouses. We serve our children. Listen to me. You don't need to serve your children. Your children need to serve God. Oh, come on now. Parents, you need to hear what I'm saying to you. So many times we put our children up on pedestals. And let me tell you something. The only time they need to be put up to a pedestal is when we're putting them up there to bar to feed them. Amen? But you see, your children need to understand there's God Almighty. There's our spouse, then there's our children, then there's our job. There's a priority in life, and when you start letting children be the main focus of your life, listen to me, you have set them up as gods, and let me tell you something, your children are not gods. Your children are heathen until they receive Jesus Christ, amen? Some people say, oh, that baby is so innocent. Let me tell you something, that baby is innocent until his first dirty diaper. At that point in time, the innocence is gone. And so all of a sudden, you start thinking, we need to teach these children who they are from a young age. Amen? And what are they? They are a gift of God. But listen to me, always respect the giver, never the gift. Because if you honor the giver, then you'll take care of the gift. Amen. How many of you got an heirloom at the house, whether it's your mama's china set, whether it's your daddy's old gun, maybe an old pickup truck, and you honor it because you loved it because it belonged to somebody. But the reason that you honor that or the reason why you take care of that is simply because you had a greater love for the person who gave it. Always keep God as your giver, your number one. Isaiah 41. Verses 17 through 20. This is where we're getting talking about the drought and the water. Isaiah 41, verses 17 through 20. It says, the poor and the needy search for water, but there is none. Their tongues are parched with thirst, but I, the Lord, will answer them, and I, the God of Israel, will not forsake them. I will make rivers flow on barren heights and springs within the valleys. I will turn the desert into pools of water, on the parched ground into springs. I will put the desert, the cedars and the acacia, the myrtle and the olive. I will set junipers in the wasteland, the fir and the cypress together, so the people may see and know and may consider and understand that the hands of the Lord has done this, that the Holy One of Israel has created it. Point number four today is we have a God that can totally change the outcome of a bad situation. You can be in the middle of a desert and have nothing else out there, no water, no trees, nothing. But what did God say? I'm going to bring the rivers. I'm going to bring the pools. I'm going to bring all that. I'm going to bring the acacias. I'm going to bring the cypress trees. I'm going to bring the olive trees. Now, guys, I grew up in Florida, and listen to me. I know what a cypress tree is. How many of you grew up near the rivers and the swamps? Oh, come on now. So if you know what a cypress tree is, it don't grow out in the middle of the desert. It does not do it. It grows in water. It grows right next to riverbanks. It actually literally grows in the rivers. So when God is saying, I'm going to bring cypress trees, guess what? You can't have cypress trees without massive amounts of water. You see, God is not just saying, I'm going to bring you some rain. How many of you know we can get rain any time of the day? But he says, I'm going to bring you massive amounts. I'm going to bring you a river, and a river supplies the needs for a long time. Guys, he's saying he's fixing to make some pools in the desert. How many of you know that you're living in really in a desert right now? And if we don't get some rain within the next 2 or 3 weeks, that won't be a prophecy. It'll be a dire truth. We need some rain. I've never been a person that's ever stood up here in the pulpit and said, Lord, I need you to bring some tropical storms in the Atlantic. I need you to bring some hurricanes into the Gulf of Mexico. I've never prayed for that. Why? Because I've always thought about what happens to the damage. But guys, we've got this high thing that's passing around here and is keeping all the cooler weather out. I don't know about y'all, but when Jesse packed up the other day, I was talking to the two guys that went up there, and listen to me, Randy told me that when him and Jesse left Alaska yesterday morning, it was 47 degrees. And all of a sudden, he drives, gets on that plane, comes all the way to Texas, and goes into 105-degree weather. But you see, by faith in Christ Jesus, I believe that we can call in some of that weather. I believe that we can, by faith in Christ Jesus, that we can believe that he will bring the rain. And you see, when we understand who he is, Jesus is that water that if we drink, let me tell you something, hell is not just a place you live. Hell is not a temperature-driven thing. Hell is the complete absence of God's presence in your life. And if you want to know what hell truly is like, go into a place where you haven't worshiped. Go into a place in your life where you haven't served, where you haven't read about what God has said. When you are walking through basically without the Spirit of God, that is a pure living testimony of hell. Guys, I don't know about y'all, but I've lived through hell. How many of you are living through a hell right now? You haven't seen God move in your life and you need a change? Guys, that can be a hell. But listen to me, all you got to do is cry out one name, and that name is Jesus. The Word says, Jesus tells us that he won't forsake us, nor would he ever walk away and leave us. Jesus is always right there with you. Jeremiah 29:11-14, everybody knows this one, but they only declare one of it. It says, for I know the plans that I have for you, declares the Lord, plans to prosper you and not to harm you, plans to give you a hope and a future. Then you will call on me and come and pray to me, and I will listen to you. You will seek me and find me when you seek me with all your heart. I will be found by you, declares the Lord, and I will bring you back from captivity. I will gather you from the nations and places where I have banished you, declares the Lord. I will bring you back to the place from which I carried you into exile. God's plans are for you, and when you submit yourself to him, he'll bring you back out of the desert. Listen to me. They were in Babylon. They were not in Israel. And when the Israelites are not in Israel, Israel doesn't flourish. But when the people of God show up, the land gets transformed. And when Israelites show up in Israel, guess what? It starts flourishing. The rivers come. Farming things happen. Right now, Israel is one of the greatest technology nations in the world. They said that today, as of today, it is also the number one place for people to go visit, to be able to go spend. They're not going to Disney World like they once did. Now they're going to the Holy City. Guys, I don't know about you, but if you look at a place that's so full of conflict, so full of problems, so much full of fighting, but yet it's the number one tourist place, that has got to be God. And you see, they want this place now where they're the number one agricultural producing nation in the world as far as technology wise. Guys, how would that happen in the desert if God wasn't involved? You see, God's involved and he's raising up this nation. And when he says, I'll bring those rivers, buddy, you better count on it. You see, I believe that Colossians 1:27 refers to Christ Jesus being our hope of glory. Guys, I guess what I want you to tell you something. You never have to live without hope, because if you got Jesus Christ, you got the hope of glory. John 7:38, one of my favorite scriptures, says, "Whoever believes in me, as scripture has said, rivers of living water will flow from within them." Guys, every time I pass the water park up here in town, come here, big boy. Come here. Come here. Yeah, come here. Every time I go up here in town, we pass the water park. What's it called? Timber Creek Falls or something? What is it called? Huh? It's the place where there's a lot of water. Amen. So every little water park has this little pool that goes around, so to speak, and it's some kind of a lazy river, right? So interesting thing about lazy rivers, you really go nowhere except you just make a circle back around. It's kind of fun just to sit there in a big old inner tube, all right? Now, yesterday I saw something funny. I was driving by, and there was a traffic jam or a clog in the river when I drove by. And it was so funny, I'd never seen this happen, but there was a lifeguard out there trying to pull apart life rafts and people, and it was two big people that was stuck up in there, and it caused a traffic jam, and people were starting to back up in there. And it was people like me and him sitting on an inner tube, sitting there thinking they're just taking it easy, going through life. Guys, there's a time that when you need to sit back and just float. The hooch, so to speak, is what we used to say in Georgia. You used to say, let's just float the Chattahoochee. Get on your inner tube and just ride it. Guys, when you get on that place and you get on that inner tube, it doesn't matter if you're small, skinny, or big. Guess what? His faith is still the same. It tells you to get on that thing and just ride. Guys, when you're on that lazy river and you got your little butt down in that hole, you got a drink up in your hand, a frozen lemonade or something like that, you don't care about anything else going on in the world, do you? Let me ask you something. If you're riding that river that says it comes from the throne room of God, why would you worry about anything else? Revelation says that that river that comes from the throne of God feeds all the nations of the earth. And if that river can feed the nations of the earth, how many of you know that big old boys like me and him ain't got nothing to worry about? Amen. The only thing that we got to worry about is raising the water level when we get in. Amen. It's like when we get in the baptismal tub, I can't put as much water when we got big people in. Amen? But you see, what we need to do is we need to be the kind of person that can raise the water level, because we trust him to get in and ride, to be able to trust him that he knows where we're going and he's going to take us where we need to go. Amen? Thank you, sir. See, I'm not going to embarrass you that bad. You see, I want you to, every time you go by the water park and you see all those people out there, I want you to start thinking. And this is what my footnote in my Bible says about John 7:38 in the scripture. It says, "Whoever believes in me, as the scripture said, rivers of living water will flow from within them." George, would you go ahead and start getting the kids in for communion, please? But in our footnote, it says, I want you to catch this, it says, "Whoever believes in me," and it says, "let them drink who believes in me. As the scripture said, out of him," or out of them, "will flow rivers of living water." Guys, when you believe in Christ Jesus, you become that source of that living water that goes forth. Guys, when you start going through life and then all of a sudden you're living in a drought, if you're not sharing water, sharing the love of Christ with somebody else, then you may be the reason that other people don't know about Jesus Christ. Guys, in church, there's probably 200 people here in church today. That means there's 200 pastors in this church. There's 200 missionaries in this church. There's 200 teachers in this church. There's 200 praise and worship leaders in this church, that when you leave here, it's about doing the work of God. It doesn't matter how qualified you are, because we all know the story that God don't call the qualified. He qualifies the called. And so when we start realizing what God is going to do with each and every one of us, God has got a purpose for each and every one of you. Whether it's serving on a motorcycle, whether it's serving on a horse, or whether it's blowing up bombs, as Rayford used to. I want you to know something. It's only God that can turn around and take somebody that knows explosives and let them retire from the postal office. Go figure. God's got a plan for each and every one of you. And guys, knowing that sometimes the path that we take may not seem correct or may not seem right, let me ask you a question. How many of you would say, Pastor, I need a chance to change my life right now? I need a chance to change. I'm completely sick and tired of living where I've been at. And I want to live a life differently, a life well spent. If that's you, I want you to bow your heads, all of you, and I want you to ask yourself, do you need a change in life? Do you need to meet Jesus Christ face to face? And if you do, today is your day to do so. Because I want to make sure that when you leave here today, that you don't leave this place without knowing Jesus personally. Because let me tell you something, you can go through 105 degree weather if you got Jesus. Without him, it's hell. Is there anybody here today say, Pastor, I need Jesus, my Lord and Savior? Would you please raise your hands right now, because I want to make sure that you do not leave this place without knowing Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. Now's the time. Anybody at all? Okay. Father, in the mighty name of Jesus, Father, I thank you that, Lord, your word says that those who believe, Lord, rivers would flow out of them. Lord, I pray in Jesus' name that, Father, each person in this room today that claims the name of Jesus Christ over their life, that walks in faith and hope and love and righteousness, that, Father, they would be a river of life, Father, that would flow out of them and, Father, start affecting our community. Father, as we get ready to start preaching next week about Elijah calling for rain, Father, I stand in agreement. Father, I stand in faith with these people today that, Lord, that you'll bring the rain. And, Lord, I pray in Jesus' name that when it comes, that people will be shocked. And, Lord, the weather forecasters won't see it coming. But, Lord, according to your word, that, Father, all you have to do is speak. So, Lord, I ask that the word of God speak over this state, over this region, over this drought. And Lord, I ask that you would speak into the droughts in our own lives and our hearts where we have had the devil try to tempt us, Father, to think about how we may doubt, how we may fear, how we may turn to something other than you. But Lord, as we've seen where Jesus resisted with the word of God, Father, I ask that, Father, that you would reveal your word to us daily. That, Father, we would walk with the anointing, with the power, Father, that we would give you all the honor and glory. That, Lord, it's not about anything that we had see or experience, but, Lord, the things that we give you credit for. So, Lord, I ask in Jesus' name that today be a day that, Father, all the gates of hell tremble because the rivers are coming for of them, Lord. Father, I pray that rain is coming. But, Lord, I pray that not only would the rain come, but, Lord, I pray for that rain from heaven. That, Lord, that your rule be on earth. That, Father, people would recognize you for who you are. So, Lord, we love you today. And, Father, these are your people. And, Lord, they are called apart and called to be separate. Lord, they're called to be righteous and holy. And, Lord, I pray in Jesus' name that, Father, that you would anoint and touch each one. That, Lord, they are the head and not the tail. They are the top and not the bottom. That, Lord, they're blessed in their comings, they're blessed in their goings. That, Lord, they're blessed in everything. That, Lord, their herds, their crops, everything, Father, is blessed and multiplied. Father, I pray that, Father, their homes are places where, Father, would be just like it would be in heaven. That, Father, their kids be blessed and highly favored and know you as Lord and Savior. In Jesus' mighty name, all God's people said. Men, I need y'all to bring over the baptismal or the communion, please. Come on, kids. I need our men to come up here and help us serve, please. Sir. Guys, a few things I want to share with you before we take communion. There's very few exceptions that I will ever give you about communion. One, some people would say, Pastor, I'm not a member of Impact Cowboy Church. I want you to look to your left and your right, and I want you to look at the person that's sitting there by you, in front of you, or behind you, and realize they're not a member neither. I care less about membership in churches. What we care about is membership in the kingdom of God. You see, a piece of paper saying you belong to someplace don't mean nothing, amen? But the blood of Christ means everything. So guys, you don't have to be a member of Impact Cowboy Church. You can be a member of First Baptist Church, First Pentecostal Church, I don't care. But are you a member of the kingdom of God? If you are, you have the right to take communion. The second exclusion is if you have any issues or you got any beefs or any problems, you need to take care of that. It says to take your offering and lay it at the altar. Then go take care of it and come back. Listen to me. We need to take that seriously. If you've got an issue or you've got a problem with someone, please take care of it. God wants to see you turn around and take communion. He wants to see you blessed. And let me tell you something. I believe there's power in communion. I believe there's healing in communion. I believe there's restoration in communion. I believe that when you come to the communion, it's about doing this in remembrance of who? Jesus Christ. And so when we take communion, it's a special thing. Communion is not one of those things that it should be taken lightly. As they get ready to pass this out, if y'all would do me a favor, if y'all would just hold on to your offerings, we'll take it all together, please. Y'all go, men. Go ahead.